all I see is a battle. You see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. If you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is the cross, God, you see the empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle begins. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Love. Opportunity to come to your house, to be in fellowship, and just to show our adoration for you. Father, none of us are worthy of your love and compassion. None of us are worthy of the path you've given us through your Son, and we are just in awe of everything you provide, of every blessing you give. Father, I just pray that our hearts and minds are open today, not to just hear the message, but to leave this place and live your message. Father, give us courage, give us strength, and give us guidance as we go into this community to do your work. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
How are we all doing? Glad to hear it. If you have not been here before, this is not how we generally set up the area where we worship. We have a meal today, which you may be able to smell as you come in. If this is your first time with us, we hope that you'll stay and eat with us and get to know us and let us get to know you and see how we might worship Jesus alongside each other. Before we dive into today's sermon, I do want to remind you of a campaign that we have going on called Pray at Home. We want you guys to be a people of prayer, and so we are encouraging, resourcing you to be a people of prayer. And so through Prayer at Home in our Home Point Center, you can find some resources back there just to get you started on that path. Some books back there that are great on prayer, some pamphlets and just ideas for how to jumpstart your own prayer life. You can also find those things online at our website as well. And so we just hope that that you are taking part in that. I've heard great things as people have done that. And so how about all the kiddos? How are you guys today?
Good.
You guys know what this is? Any of the kids know what this is? This is garbage.
Oh my God. No.
This would be a bow and arrow, right? This one has seen better days, but it is the idea of a bow and arrow. And you know how a bow and arrow works, right?
Yeah.
You guys know how it works, right? You have to connect the arrow to the string, right? Someone would call that knocking the arrow. You have to draw it, right? Create potential for it to go forward, and then once you have it there, I saw earlier this thing doesn't fly very far or very straight. Zach took out Lance's guitar with it, and so rather than taking out the guitar, I'll just aim at someone who draws pictures of me. Oh man, I'm on the wrong side here. I gotta be on the other. Oh, here we go. Oh. Oh. I told you it wasn't a good one, but that's what we had. So, hey, what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about how in this picture of what it looks like to reach the next generation, we're trying to connect the next generation to God. We're trying to connect them, right? And then we're trying to draw them, to create potential in them to fly into the kingdom the way that they're supposed to as God's creation. And then at some point in time, we're going to have to release them to do that, right? And so that's kind of the picture that we're drawing throughout these 3 weeks. We talked about connecting last week, this week. Listen for the word draw. And we're going to talk about drawing the potential out of you that we want to see in you as the next generation of the church. And so that's where we are this morning. We've been going through our strategic plan. And as we do that this morning, I'm going to do something a little bit different, okay? You guys aren't going to be ready for this, but this is an all-play exercise that each and every person in this room is going to play along with. Okay, you don't know it yet, but you're going to, okay? And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to call out the different generations of the church and have you guys stand with me so that we can see how many people there are. And I see that Barb is all the way back in the back of the room. And as a math teacher, this is going to be right up your alley, okay? So as they stand, you're going to be my official count, okay? And so you just count the number of people who stand for each of these areas of the generations of the church, okay? So the first ones are those, and we're just going to say baby boomers and beyond that. If there's anybody beyond baby boom, we're not going to call anybody's name, but you know, just know that these are all of the folks that were born before the year of 1965. And so if you were born before 1965, stand up for me. Barb, you on it? All right, so 1965. These are our pre-1965ers. You got six people, what Barb was giving me as our official count. Six people. Okay. How about those who are part of Generation X? Generation Xers. That is everyone between 1965 and 1980 is what we're counting. You can find different metrics for this. But all right. 1965 and 1980. Count myself and yourself, Barb, because we're in that generation. How many you got? She says 22? 22, okay. So, 22 between 19... there we go, beautiful. All right.
2005.
All right, we are at 28 people right now. Okay, let's see where we go. Wait, she's gonna be a millennial, it'll be fine. All right, we need Generation Z. No, we need millennials. Okay, Generation Y or millennials. This is going to be all of those between 1981 and 1996. 1996. If you were born 1 year after I got out of high school, you still qualify. All right. So, up to 1996. Barb, you see 11? 11. All right. 11 of the millennial generation, the Generation Yers. Now we need Generation Z. All right. If you are... born between, Generation Z is between 1997 and 2013. 97 and 13. If you're smaller, you can stand on a chair if you need to, okay? That was just for Gabby. All right.
And Riley.
Barb, over here, Riley.
She's sitting down.
Was that 20?
She says 22. 22 up to 2000, what'd I say, 13? Okay, so 2014 and beyond are Generation Alpha. I didn't even know this was a thing yet, but 2014 on to today is Generation Alpha. So if you have a Generation Alpha, yeah, hold them up or stand on a chair, all right? How many did you come up with, Barb? Maybe 14. All right. So that is a good thing. This is a positive sign for the church, right? When you have people who are on this half lower than people on this half, that is a good thing for the future of the church, right? That's a foundation that we can build upon as we look forward and celebrate young people that we are passing the faith of what we know about Jesus onto, so that they can take off with what God has called them to be. And so, hey, here's a couple more that I'm going to do that are going to cross age groups, okay? You don't have to stand up for these. I'm just going to have you raise hands, and Barb, you don't have to count for these. But how about all of those who are firstborn children? Where are the firstborn children's out? Okay. It's a good number, right? How many of you guys are the last child born, the baby of the family? How many of you guys are the best children, the middle children? Yeah. That's me. All right. How many of you guys have brown eyes? Where are my brown-eyed people? That's a like a lower number than I expected for brown eyes. That's like the dominant trait, right? How about blue-eyed people? How many blue-eyed people? See, that's why you guys get along with me. These are my people. How about green or hazel? Okay. Not quite as many as the blues. I think blues win. I'm not sure. It seemed like we had more firstborns than we had middles or youngers, just in my looking. But I'm going to count the middles as winning that one, too.
What about the only children?
Only children? Well, then you're the first child born. And the last child born. You can be all of those, right?
That's not true.
You can be everything but a middle in that case. All right. How about people who love Jesus? Any of those here? All right. Yeah. See, this is the point, right? We have something that combines us together in one category better than all of the things that separate us into different categories, right? We have something that is much greater than all of the different age groups that we could separate into, all of the different, if we separated by sexes, right? We could about 50-50 split into groups that way. All of the different ways that we could separate ourselves, we have something so much greater that combines us together. And last week we started to talk about passing on our faith from one generation to the next. And so what we're calling this is Reach Now, right? The idea of we have this window of time before kids are graduated and leave the nest of their parents. We have this small window of time where we're trying to pass on our faith to the next generation. And that's really what we're talking about. And we've expressed our Reach Now this way. Every believer at Oikos invests their time, treasure, and their talent to reach and keep the next generation. That we want every single person here involved in our efforts, in our mission to reach the next generation. To invest our time, our talent, our treasure, the things that God has blessed us with, that we would use those things so that we would see the next generation come to know and to love the Jesus that we have come to know and to love. So we want to reach them and we want to keep them in Jesus. And so the reason that I started out the way that I had was that man, we have a diverse population of people, but we have something so much greater that we can say unites us together, that keeps us together, that will hold us together past any slight or any offense that we could have. And so, in fact, we read about this all throughout the New Testament writings of the earliest people who were writing about the church, right? We see the way that they talked about what holds us together, what we can come together around. Paul, as he's writing to an early church, he writes about this. And so if you want to follow along in a Bible, if you have a Bible with you or an app that has a Bible app on, or a phone with a Bible app, and you want to follow along with me, I'm going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 today. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. This is Paul just writing to some early Christians in a church in a city called Corinth. You have a question back there?
So you have 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians?
It's
this thing.
So
you have
2 Corinthians. Oh, well, that would be maybe because I put the wrong number, because that's 1 Corinthians, but I probably just made a typo. That's fine, though. Thanks for pointing that one out. all right. So here's what he writes to these folks that are in the city of Corinth, these early Christians. He says, there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord, right? There are different kinds of gifts that we have, different talents, different abilities that we have that God gives to us, but the same God has given these things to us, right? He says, there are different kinds of workings, but all of them, in all of them, and in everyone, is the same God at work. Now, to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good, right? And so all of these gifts and abilities and talents that we have are given to us. Why? for the common good, right? So that we would serve the people that he has placed in fellowship with us, that we would look outwardly and not inwardly, right? That we aren't the end and the means in and of ourselves for what God is trying to do in our lives, but actually his church is, right? The body of Christ is what these gifts were given to us for, so that we could serve the body. He says, just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all of its parts are formed this one body, so it is with Christ. And so even though we have a diverse cast of characters that are here today, we all come together as one unit, as the body of Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body, whether Jew or Gentile, slave or free, and we were given all one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now, if the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body, right? Your parts of your body can't just say, I'm not part of the body. They're part of the body whether they want to be or not, right? And if an ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I don't belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And so every part of your body is important, so we don't just say, hey, the unimportant parts we don't have to worry about, right? They're all part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But, in fact, God has placed the parts of the in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one body, where would the body be, right? And so we have these different parts that come together and form the body. As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head can't say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker or are indispensable, and those parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. And the parts that are unpresentable, we treat with special modesty. While our presentable parts need no special treatment, but God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that lack it. So, that there should be no division in the body, but its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part of the body suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each of you is a part of that body. And so what Paul is doing here is he's placing the importance of all of the different faculties of a body put together, right? And so when we hear the word church, we generally think of what? A place, right? A building, an organization. When Paul talks about the church in the New Testament, throughout the New Testament, every time we hear the word church, it's not about a building, it's not about a place, it's about a people. A people that God has placed together. The church is the assembly of God's people as they come together. And so he says, whenever we come together with each other in mind. We come together with loving one another and serving one another as the point for why we are coming together. If you look through that whole passage and you count up the number of times you see the words body, part, or member, you'll do a lot of counting. I've tried to count through them, and what I come up with more than anything else was 36 times you see body, part, or member, right? And you might have a different version or a different count, and that's fine. The point is, it's a lot, right? It's a lot of times that we see those words, body and part and member. Why? Because he's trying to make a point here to us that though there is diversity in the parts of the body, there is unity in the fact that these are all parts of the body of Christ, right? We come together because of who he is and how he's knit us together. And so Paul is describing the function of the church, and he's describing it as a body, right? And truly, anywhere you ever see the word membership, this is the etymology of it. This is where it comes from, right? I've kind of discussed this before, but this is where that word comes from. This idea in Christianity of the different parts of the body of Christ is where membership comes from. Whether you're a member of a team, an organization, a club, whether you're a member of a big box store, right? That's where that word comes from. The idea of Christianity and how we are members of the body of Christ. The fundamental point Paul is making here is that, and I've probably said this before as well, but we're not part of a team, right? This isn't membership in a club, but rather this is belonging to a body that God calls us to, that he draws us together so that we be part of this body that is called the body of Christ. That no matter how old you are or young you are, no matter how male you are or female you are, no matter how much we might separate over education or stage of life or anything else that we might use to draw distinctions or make categories or separate over, there is something so much greater that draws us together, and that is the body and the blood of Jesus, right? This is the one thing that makes us distinct. Over anywhere else you will ever come together with other people, this is what makes us distinct, that we are part of the body of Christ. That the King of all creation has said, I want you to be part of this part of the body of Christ. I'm drawing you together, and I'm knitting you together in such a way that you will serve one another, and you will love one another, and you will care for one another in a way that is totally different from any other association that you will have in your life. I was looking through Facebook this week, and a friend of mine in ministry, he had shared a post, and so I shared it along with him. But it was a post about the fact that when we're in church and we hear loud noises, and we hear things that might be a distraction to us in everyday life, right? When we are in the church, those things are amazing, because they're the sounds of young people, right? They're the sounds of the loudness in the quiet when everyone's praying or when everything's, you know, seems to get a little bit quiet. You always hear that one child that's you know, really, really, really loud. And we call her Ivy. That's our, oh, I'm sorry. No, there's always those children that are loud, and that's a beautiful thing, right? We want to hear those things, because that is the future of the body of Christ. That is the ones that are going to come up behind us, and that is the next generation, as we think about them, that we need to pass our faith along to. And so one of the ways that we talk about this every week is that we come together in communion, right? And we have that opportunity where we all bow our heads and we all meditate upon what God has done for us, and we all hear those young ones that are going on in the background. And so we dare not sequester them off. We dare not shut them up. We just want them to be here. We want to enjoy Christ along with them. And so I'm going to invite up Lance. He's going to enter us into a time around the Lord's table.
Take my brother with me. Okay.
Sean took his bow. The Tanners brought theirs as well. It's a little different, though.
Different sort.
Different kind of bow. Spelled a little different. So this week, as I started thinking about how do I tie communion in with the next generation, initially that was a daunting task. And when I sat down and prayed about it and thought about it, it just kind of, you know, God gives you the words you need to say. So I have two kids, as pretty much everybody here knows. They're 21 and 17 now, so most people wouldn't call them kids, but I still do. And I can't think of a better way to gain some comprehension of God's love for us than to become a parent. I thought I knew exactly what love was, and then the nurse handed Grace to me. I looked into her eyes, and I realized that all those years before, I had no real understanding of what sacrificial love truly was. I'd seen examples of it, but I hadn't really felt it. I knew I had a lot to learn, but I also had the perfect example in my Heavenly Father. Suddenly, there were many things that had been important that no longer really mattered. My child mattered more. And 4 years later, a different nurse handed Gabby to me, and I was flooded with the same emotions. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 says, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God." He calls us his children. I would go to any length to provide for and to protect my children. Now consider how God has done that for us. There's been many times that my kids have messed up. We all have. But it didn't change my love for them at all. It didn't change the lengths I would go for them. Romans 5:8 mimics that in God's love, and it says, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Now that's love. That's a level of compassion we can't ever truly understand. That is a love that can't be duplicated. But as a dad, I understand better now than I used to. 2,000 years ago, God proved what lengths he would go to for us, to meet our needs and to pay a debt owed by all of us that none of us could pay. He sent his son, who lived in poverty, who often went to sleep hungry, and who demonstrated love and compassion everywhere he went, to teach us how to love one another. We must continue to strive to be like and love like Jesus loved. Look around at all the young people in our presence for a minute. Sean counted them. Lost my place. Okay, there they are. I was counting. They aren't someone else's kids. And they aren't someone else's responsibility. They're our kids. Proverbs 22:6 says, "Start children off on the way they should go, and even when they're old, they will not turn from it." We must teach our kids about God's love, about the sacrifice Jesus made, and about not turning from God when they're older. That's an example we are called to live by and to demonstrate. After Jesus was finished teaching, he took our place on the cross, a promise made and a promise kept. He didn't just talk about love, he demonstrated it. And as you prepare to partake of the elements, please reflect for a moment. Think about your relationship with God. Think about the influence you have on those younger than you, in age and in their walk with Christ. And give thanks to God for your salvation. Think about how you'll teach those younger than you to love like Jesus did. And teach them what communion demonstrates. I'm going to pray in a moment, but when I'm finished, I'm going to ask you to do the same. Take some time to be in silent prayer. Reflect, confess, give thanks, demonstrate your faith. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all you give us. We thank you today especially for our young people. Ages brand new to whatever it may be. Father, we just thank you for filling this church with voices, with little people that we have been put in charge of teaching about you, of loving like you, of showing you. Father, I thank you so much for the example of love you gave in your Son and for him teaching us and giving us perfect examples of how to love one another, how to treat one another, and how to sacrifice. And Father, we thank you most of all for the sacrifice he made on the cross for us. We pray these things in his name. Amen.
I can remember when I was in fifth or sixth grade, somewhere in that neighborhood, that I figured out for the first time that I needed to wear glasses. I say that, but I knew I needed to wear glasses. I was at baseball practice, and my coach wanted to know why I was continually late swinging. Like, every time I would come through the strike zone, I was late. I was sending it to right field. I was sending it to second base. You know, just every time, slow through the zone. And so he said, "Man, something's wrong here." And he tried to work with me on it. And he tried to adjust my stance. And finally, he had me look at a couple of things around the stadium or the field. And he was having me identify things. And he said, as my mom came to pick me up, he said, "Your boy needs glasses. He can't see." And I knew that because what I had done was every time we would. Public school, you know, they run you through a line of people that are all doing the eye test at the same time. And so there's the big chart on the wall, and you just listen to what the kid before you said, and you say the same thing they said, you don't have to wear glasses. That's how that works, right? So that was what I did, which worked out pretty well for me until my coach figured that out and said, hey, listen, if you want to hit the ball and you want to send it to the right part of the field, you know, you probably need to wear some glasses. And so I did. And my mom took me to the optometrist and I had myopia, you know, nearsightedness, had to have glasses for the first time. And that started a couple decades worth of wearing glasses and then contacts. And finally I got LASIK surgery. Now I have to deal with any of that anymore, right? But I can look around the room and I can see a few of you guys had the same problem I had, right? You have myopia, you have nearsightedness, or at least you're wearing glasses like you do. Maybe you're just making a fashion statement, I don't know. But even with all of the folks that have glasses on, I'm sure that there are others that have contacts, that are wearing contacts today, right? And we need some sort of correction in our vision. The question is, what happens when we need a spiritual solution for our nearsightedness, right? What is it that in us that makes us, instead of looking at the long-term effects, just think, what's right here in front of us, and how can we solve for what we have right here? And so often within the church, we hear the sounds of young people, and we see them moving around, and we see the need for more space, and we think, well, let's shuttle those kids off, and we'll put them in a spot right here where they can learn about God on their level, and we'll be over here and we'll learn about God on our level, and we'll just kind of silo or separate things out, and it'll work out well. But the problem is that that's very nearsighted. While it is a solution, it's not always the right solution, right? And so what we've found out from about 50 years of doing church that way, or building churches that way, is that we have generations that are coming up behind us that aren't being effectively discipled because of this siloing of the body of Christ. And just as we talked about earlier, the body of Christ, if you have a part that you take off of the body, what happens to that part of the body? Well, it dies, right? It doesn't have the nutrients. In the same way that we need to be connected to the vine, Christ, right? To abide in Christ, to have the nutrients we need, we all need to be connected to the body. And so over time, what we've found is that over and over and over, as we separate things from the body, they end up not functioning the way that they're supposed to. They don't have the same growth, the same care. And so we talked about a statistic last week of 70 to 80% of students, as they graduate from high school and they go off to college, within 2 years will stop attending church. And there's a good reason for that, because they never felt like they were part of the church. They felt like they were part of a children's ministry. They felt like they were part of a youth group. But then they get past that age and they go off to college, and they never felt like they were part of the body of the church. And so we need to look after that. As we've talked about before, that the church is never more than one generation away from extinction, right? Every single generation has the responsibility and the duty of passing their faith off to the next generation. That's our job. We have to pass that faith on, because the church is never more than one generation from being extinct. And so we need to have young people. Not just have young people, but have young people attached to the body, to have the nutrients that comes from being part of the people of Jesus. A year ago, I read an article in The Atlantic they put out that said, why are American teens so sad? And it explained that the United States is experiencing an extreme teenage mental health crisis. And between the years of 2009 and 2021, they said that there was a rise in the persistent feelings of sadness or hopelessness. It raised from 26% to 44% in that time. So between 2009 and 2021, the hopelessness or despair in teenagers went from 26%, which is about one in every four, still a scary statistic, right, to almost half, right? 44% of teenagers felt this sense of hopelessness or despair, sadness, deep persistent sadness inside. And why is that? Why would we have this decade that makes this huge difference and so they went on and they tried to explain that in the article. And the reasons that they proposed for it were the introduction of social media to teenagers.
The idea of them being connected in a way that they were never connected before, and being able to be bullied or pushed into different states of mind that they never had access to before that time, and at the same time having less interactions physically with other people, and so being drawn away from the physical interactions and being drawn into these technological interactions over and over and over. What we saw was that in that same 10 years, the amount of teenagers who were driving drastically decreased. No longer was that so important. When I was a teenager, man, that was the first thing I wanted to do was have my driver's license, have a car, because then I was free. That's not so much anymore. The kids are slowly stopping wanting to have their driver's license as much. That they don't have jobs in the same way they did when I was a teenager. That there's just more in the outside world that is stressful and is berating them, is inundating them with all of this information and all of this drama that's all around them in our society. That we have social media and we have 24-hour news that is constantly giving them this sense of dread for the world around us. And that's a scary thing for teenagers today. Kids are growing up faster. They're exposed to more things, and yet they are maturing slower, right? They're not getting licensed. They're not getting freedom. They're not moving on out of their parents' homes as early. They're not getting married as early. They're all of the signs of maturity are slowing down while they're being inundated with things that are making them exposed to so much more, so much faster. And so, what we want to see here is that teenagers desperately need for older Christians, for Christians who are in their faith to model that before them. They need models of just solid Christianity before them, models of people who are sold out to Jesus and pursuing this example of Christian discipleship. Fuller Theological Seminary had a recent study that they uncovered that one of the greatest things that help young people navigate their faith is seeing their parents or other Christian adults navigate their faith. The number one thing in this book called Sticky Faith, that was kind of a summary of that entire study, was that they need that model before them. They need to see in their parents, they need to see in other Christian adults, just them navigate the struggles of life, to deal with hardships as they come, to see adult people who are dealing with different failures in their lives or different health concerns that come up, and just watching how we deal with that helps them deal with that as they come about those same things. They need this living example of how to connect their faith with the faith that they see before them. We've heard that it takes a village to raise a child. You've heard that before, right? It takes a family of faith to raise a faithful child. It takes the family of God to come together to raise faithful children. That they need not just their parents, they need their parents, but they also need other adults that are sold out to showing them and to modeling before them the kind of faith that they are to mature into. And so we need to pass on our stories of faith from one generation to the next, our stories of transformation and the way that God has taken us from one place to another, the way that they need to see our struggles and our successes, they need to see our failures and our victories, they need to see all of those things modeled before them in the people of faith that God has placed them in the body along with. And so over and over, we see this pattern lived out in Jesus, right? We see the way that he took these young men and he said, hey, come with me, follow me, live with me, see the way that I live my life. I'm going to model this before you. I'm going to show you what it looks like to be a person who is sold out to God. And so he takes these disciples with him and he walks this earth, and he lives the human example of what it looks like to be perfect in the eyes of God, to be sold out for what it is that God wants us to do. Jesus does this perfectly. We're not going to, right? That's just the reality of it. You're not going to do this perfectly, but you can model this for the people who are around you. You can model this for the next generation and be an example of what that looks like. Paul understood this very well. And so Paul, as he's writing to one of these early churches, he says this. He says, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. Right? And so he's saying what? Just look, I'm following Jesus. Follow after me and let's do this together. right? I'm going to be a model for you of what it looks like to follow after Jesus. And I'm going to put myself out there to the person who's coming up behind me saying, hey, listen, I'm willing for you to follow me as I follow Jesus, because I'm going to do it to the best of my ability. And so you can just come and you can try to emulate that in your life. And so here's the question, I think, that cuts to the heart of what this looks like for you and I, for those in this room who want to invest in the next generation. That is, what if you invested your energy into modeling your faith to the next generation in authentic relationship? Right? What would it look like for you to model your faith, to take your time to model before those who are coming up behind you, to be a picture for them of what faith looks like? Right. Not only does the next generation need models, they need moments. They need these areas where they're struggling with something, and they need people to speak into that. Right. They need to know that when they have these valleys in life and they're slugging through all the obstacles that life seems to be putting before them, they need people who hear the problems that they have and respond to that with faith and tell them about God's unfailing love for each and every person, right? They tell them about God's unending care for their struggles that they're feeling and the obstacles that they're facing. They tell them about how he's never going to leave them, that his presence is going to be with them even when they're struggling through those things, that he's not going to leave them on their own, but he's going to walk through it along with them, and that God's faithfulness through each and every one of those obstacles and every valley that they face, he's going to be there, and he's going to be faithful to them as they're faithful to God. They need older folks, more mature folks in the faith, to recognize these opportunities in conversation, right? These moments where we have an opportunity to turn it and to give them a piece of encouragement, a piece of maybe correction in the way that they're thinking, or a little bit of training in what it looks like to put the things together in their lives, to see the way that God would call them to be and the way that they're living and make those things come a little bit closer into perspective. We need constantly to hear the things of God around us. And Jesus realized this too, right? Again, he's the perfect example for us. He modeled this in his own life. As he's going from one place to another, somebody asks him a question, he starts talking about it. He sees a woman who's off by herself at a well in the middle of the day, and he sees that as an opportunity for a conversation. And he goes over and he talks to her. He sees people at the side of the road who are yelling out to him, and rather than walking by, he goes over and he talks to them. He sees crowds of people. He sees sisters standing at the side of the grave of their brother, and he says, hey, that's an opportunity. This is a moment that I have that I can go and I can talk to them about what it is that they're dealing with. Jesus was always ready with a story. He always had a parable that would illustrate this in their lives. That would illuminate what it looks like to follow after God. He had an experience or a piece of advice that he could give them, right? And we all have this. You all have areas of your life where wisdom that you've grown from. And maybe it's a negative example. Maybe it's something that you didn't do right, and you don't want someone else to suffer through it. And so that's an area where you can pass that on. But over and over and over, we can catch these moments in conversation where somebody is saying something that we can help them build their faith through. And so the question in this area is, what if we invested our time in order to create those moments, to train and to teach the next generation? What if we, again, invest our time into having our ears perked for those moments when we can pass those things on to the people who God has placed in fellowship along with us? Last but certainly not least, our people need not just those moments. They need not just the modeling, but they need milestones, right? They need to be celebrated when something great happens, when they hit a plateau in their walk with Christ, and we see that in them. They need people who will recognize that in them and celebrate them and tell them, hey man, you're doing great. I'm seeing a level of maturity in you today that I didn't see in times past. And man, I want to celebrate that in you. I want to bring you along so that you see that in yourself as well. This is something we're gonna dive into a little bit more next week as we kind of look forward to launching them out into life. The way that we can celebrate them, we can celebrate these milestones in their life. But I just want to think about for this week one interaction where we see this in the life of Jesus. Again, he's going to be the greatest example for us in most of these areas. One of those areas where he saw a milestone moment, he recognizes that, he celebrates that, is in the life of Peter, right? In Matthew chapter 16, there's this moment where Jesus has been walking around, he's hearing the crowds of people talk about who he was, and so he turns this question on to his disciples, and he asks them, who do people say that I am? And this is the reply he gets. Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets. So they kind of say you're like one of the Old Testament prophets. And then he turns it on them, right? Okay, that's great. That's what you've heard. What about you? He asks, who do you say that I am? And this is a really important question, right? This is the question that each and every person in this room is going to have to answer at some point in time. Who is Jesus? Who is he to you? Is he the Lord? Is he Savior? Is he the one who gave his life in your place for your sins, or is he not? Right? Who is Jesus to you? And Peter, being the spokesman of the group, he's always the one that has to shoot out his opinion, right? So he says, I mean, you're the Messiah. You're the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father who is in heaven. So Jesus sees this moment where Peter has said something that is a milestone, right? This is a big statement that Peter has made. He says, hey, listen, on this statement, this is so important that my church is going to be built on this. He says, I tell you that you are Peter, which just means rock, right? Foundation. This is a foundational thing that you've just said. And so you're going to be my rock in the church. And on this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. And so he sees this moment in Peter's life, this milestone for him, and he celebrates it in Peter, and he gives him a new name. From that point on, he's called Peter, right? And he's not going to seem like the rock in a lot of times. He's going to seem like shifting sand over times in his life. He's gonna deny Jesus. He's gonna be afraid of little girls around a campfire at some point, and be ready to sell Jesus down the river. And yet, Jesus says, "Hey, listen, on this statement, on what you just said right there, we can build something. We can build a church, an assembly of the people of God that the gates of Hades, hell itself, cannot overcome." And he says, this is something we need to celebrate. And so our question for us to think about is what if we invested our treasure, our time, our efforts, our energy? What if we celebrated those milestones for young people around us to encourage them toward maturity? Where are the moments in time that we can pick that we say, hey, you know what, that right there, that's a moment where you're going to look back and this is going to be a solid moment for you to stand on. This is going to be a solid moment for you to plateau and to build upon as you continue to mature in Christ. And see, in all three of these questions, the only one who's going to be able to answer is you. I can't answer that for you. What would it look like for you to invest your time, your talent, and your treasure in the next generation? You've got to answer that question. What does it look like in your life to create moments where you can have these conversations with people from the next generation? What would it look like for you to have to model that before them, to be a model of Christian maturity for the people in the next generation? What would it look like for you to create these milestone moments where you can build upon the things that kids are going through and the life experiences that they're having? And I know that as we eat a meal together today, you're going to have an opportunity to do that. Right, you're going to have these moments where you can sit at a table that's not just with people who look just like you or who are at the same age development as you are, but you can sit with people and you can find out where they are. You can see what they're struggling with. You can see where you can come alongside of them in prayer and in care and in concern and how you can celebrate them for where they are in their walk with Jesus, so you can build them toward Christian maturity. And this opportunity to talk with folks is going to be all around us as we come together for a meal this morning. So I would just challenge you to take full advantage of that and see what it looks like for you to model and to build moments and to celebrate milestones with the young people that God has placed in our fellowship. Our Father in heaven, we just thank you so much for another day, another time, another opportunity that we can come and we can humble ourselves at your feet. Father, we thank you so much for the example that we find in Jesus, an example of someone who modeled faith for us. Father, who showed us what true Christian maturity looks like in his life. Father, we thank you so much that he had these incredible moments where he would share with the people that he had saw around him, the people who were experiencing great tragedy, sometimes great questions or doubts of faith, people who were in their lowest moments or were in the struggles of life, that he would come and he would have these moments with them where he would give them hope, that he would offer to them a little bit of correction or thought direction where they could take that wisdom and run with it. Father, we thank you so much for Jesus, the fact that he came to build a bridge between us and you, and for all of the milestones in our lives that we can look back to that have brought us to this point in time where we can celebrate who you are and how you've made us. Father, as we just look to Jesus, understanding that he is the embodiment of everything that we were called to be to the next generation, Lord, I just ask you to help us to rise to the challenge of seeing that in our children, seeing that in our grandchildren, seeing that in the children of the family of faith that you have placed around us. Opportunities we have to model and to have moments and to celebrate milestones with them. We love you and we thank you so much for Jesus, for the forgiveness of our sins that we have because of what he came and did on our behalf for our sins. We love you and thank you for Jesus. In his name that we pray. Amen. If you'll stand with us, we're going to have a song of reflection and response, a moment of introspection maybe, where you can think about where it is that you can meet with the people that God has placed around you, where you can be one who invests your time and talent and treasure into those folks. Maybe this is a moment today where you're answering that question, who is Jesus? And you want to celebrate the fact that you see that he is the Messiah, the Son of the living God, and want to follow him into the grave of baptism. If that's where you are this morning, I'm going to be up here in the front. I would love to talk with you more about it. We're going to be here for the entirety of the meal. I would love to talk with you about it. Where are you today, and what is it that God is calling you to? Let's move in that direction.
Glory, glory.
take a seat for a few announcements.